Welcome, everybody. I'm really excited to share with you all some work that I've been focusing on. And it's through my, it's initially through my role as a One Health scholar. And I've also, through that experience, gotten an opportunity to participate in an ORIDE project called Expanding Horizons, which has been a great influence as well. So I'm really excited to share with you all today these ideas. And so the focus is consilience through a tool called Liberating Structures and also through APT methodologies, which we'll define. And I know that there are so many wonderful researchers who are focusing on the science of team science at the university. So I see this, and I think the One Health Initiative sees this as one of many talks that will focus on the science of team science. So just a tiny little bit of background for me. I have been taking Latin since I was in sixth grade, and it was my first job as a teacher when I got out of school. I also founded the Vet Social Work Program in 2002, and I'm an interfaith minister, so I like blending things. And lastly, I've been teaching the mindfulness-based stress reduction course here at the university since 2004, and my eldest brother became a Buddhist monk when I was very young, so taught me to meditate when I was very, very young. I have another brother who is a botanist, and so all of that has an impact on what I'll share with you today. So I share with you just a little bit about my frame, where I'm coming from. So what we'll do today is define some terms. We'll talk about the definition of consilience. We'll talk about APT methodologies. APT is defined as adaptive, participatory, and transdisciplinary. Then we will provide an overview of something called liberating structures. This time that we'll have together today will be participatory, but not in breakout rooms. So don't be afraid. I'm not going to surprise you and put you in a breakout room. Although I think breakout rooms are fabulous, we won't do them today, but we will collaborate in curating a list of folks that are working in the consilience space at the university. So Alyssa, I think, is gonna post right now a Google Doc, and I invite you to be messy. I have posted some questions that can guide you in sharing what you know about ways in which people are working interdisciplinarily as transdisciplinary science teams. And if we could get that information in this collaborative Google Doc, it'll be a great start. And of course, this document will be a living document and something that is continuing to be open and available to everyone. We will also use the Animate tool on Zoom at one point. We will use a little polling through Slido. I definitely will just touch on this idea of wicked problems. I will absolutely have a mention about the brain. Then I'll end talking about our good colleague, Dr. Mehmet Adeniz, who has started something called Collabs, who I hope will give a One Health Initiative Science of Team Science talk soon. And then I have a little save the date. So that's kind of where we're going and what we'll be doing today. So at this point, I hope that you all have logged on to the Consilience Collaborative document and are starting to share who you are, what you do, units. There are units that are posted there that you might be affiliated with, and you can add any additional information that you think we should understand about your unit and how your unit is rocking it at UT. Get messy and just creative and throw it all in there. Okay, here's the Latin bit. I got to go back to the etiology of the term consilience, and it comes from salui saltum, and it means to spring, leap, or jump, or bound together. And then con, of course, which is together. The real ideology of that, though, is there. So it is not, consilience is not just, hey, let's work together. It's like gregarious. It's like jump in, right? Jump in without necessarily knowing everything, is the ideology, at least, for the term. I think E.O. Wilson, who wrote a whole book about consilience, the unity of knowledge, references the coining of the term, or the way in which he understands the term to be useful, stemming from William Wilhel in a paper called The Philosophy of the Inductive Sciences, where William wrote, the consilience of inductions takes place when an induction obtained from one class of facts coincides with an induction obtained from another class. This consilience is a test. And I don't know if you've had the experience before, but I definitely have, when people from different disciplines all of a sudden are like, oh, that makes sense, from everybody's frame. So, of course, E.O. Wilson, this wonderful biologist, wrote a whole book on consilience, the unity of knowledge. And consilience is often kind of acknowledged as being the blending of the biological sciences and the social sciences, but then you add things like ethics in. And so E.O. Wilson talks about there being concentric circles, and that the closer you get into the center where all of those circles meet is where you hit, where that convergence occurs, which is another term, of course, that is used, although E.O. Wilson says he really does prefer consilience. When you get to that place, that is the place of consilience. And he says, as we, cross the circles inward towards that inner point, we find ourselves in an increasingly unstable and disoriented region. The ring closest to the intersection where most real-world problems exist is the one in which fundamental analysis is most needed, yet virtually no maps exist. Few concepts and words serve to guide us. Now, of course, E.O. Wilson wrote this in 1999, and now it's 2021. So there has certainly been more maps that have been created and more concepts and words that have also been laid forth to help guide us in these convergent spaces. So this brings me to the brother that is a botanist. And when I was a kid, he said to me, he's serious science. So we had this Buddhist, we had, my brother. Both my parents were seminarians. My brother's this atheist, hardcore science kind of guy. And he says to me as a kid, science starts with moments that make you go, hum. And that always had a big impact in me. And so I have that feeling of, intensely about this idea of consilience. And it started, of course, in 2020, when all of the pandemic hit and all the social unrest has happened. And I found also during this process, this term wicked problem. Now, many of you in the room, you're like old hat. You already knew about wicked problems. You've been dealing with them for a long time. It has been new for me. And so I'm sharing with you a little bright-eyed view of these topics. So I want to be humble and respectful of all the wisdom that's already here. And that's why we have that messy Google Doc. So if you're not adding things to that, I hope that you will. Okay, but wicked problems, right? A problem that is difficult or impossible to solve because of incomplete, contradictory, or changing requirements that are often difficult to recognize. And then the plot thickens, because then I find out about these sustainable development goals. I had no idea about these sustainable development goals. It was one Sunday and I was, on YouTube, and I found this amazing video about the SDGs. And I realized, wow, this is like a strategic plan for the world. And then I found out, I know what happened. Hold on one second. had them linked up to all the sustainable development goals. So then my graduate student, I asked her to sleuth about and find out, you know, SDGs at the university. Of course, all of you know this, but this was news, how well the university is doing already. And this is actually not completely up to date. I know that Jamie Gowan has more precise information about this, but UT is really doing great work around the SDGs. And of course, Tom Gill is teaching a class about it right now. And so it was really exciting to me to learn about the SDGs. And those ideas converged for me. And I really saw, wow, each of these SDGs can be considered as a wicked problem, where the concept includes that every problem is unique. There is no clear problem definition. It's multi-causal, multi-scalar and interconnected. There is no clear problem definition, multiple stakeholders with conflicting agendas, straddle organizational and disciplinary boundaries. Every solution ramifies throughout the system. Solutions are not, I love this one, not right or wrong, but better or worse, and can take a long time to evaluate. And they're not ever completely solved. Phew. So as scientists, certain types of scientists, the idea that a problem can never be solved is, I think, a challenging idea. So my first poll for you is, what do you think? Do you agree that many of the SDGs meet the description of what a wicked problem is? You can go to slido.com and enter that number, or you can get your phone and turn on your camera and get this QR code. And that will take you to this poll and you can answer this poll. There's always this moment. Okay, thank goodness. Okay, so we have strongly agree. Either agree or disagree. Good. Keep them coming. Only got four so far. We have about 28 folks in the room. So far about 43% are kind of strongly agree or agree. Nobody's disagreeing at this point. Yeah, good. So for the interest of time, I'm going to keep moving along. But I think that there's a lot of great dialogue that can be had, and I think it is being had in the coursework on SDGs. I integrated it into my conflict resolution class last semester. So there's a lot of great dialogue that's going on around SDGs. Certainly there's research to indicate, or perspective papers and opinions to indicate that SDGs definitely require a transdisciplinary innovation at the local scale. And then I just got informed about this term glocal from our good colleague, Carol Myers, who sent me a paper from nursing, an award-winning paper about global issues and applying the local solutions to them. So that our local solutions are informed by the global awareness of what we're facing as a world. So then I thought, okay, well, what about my local environment? Well, I have to tell you, the people that live around me, like in my neighborhood, some of them, they have a very strong opinion that I can think for myself, and they definitely do not want an expert telling them what to do or think. So they are opposed to this idea that there is some expert that's gonna have the answer, and they wanna think for themselves. And so this makes me curious about when we as in higher education become expert on things, how well are we at actually influencing people's behavior and opinions about wicked problems. And so You know, I think that there's work, as you all well know, being done about how do we develop leaders to tackle these wicked problems. And I think UT is definitely doing it. And then I found this adaptive, participatory, and transdisciplinary methodologies APT. And I was doing some research around the food system and got really excited about this idea of adaptive, participatory, and transdisciplinary work. So it's been referenced a little bit in the literature, but I'm sure that there are many other frameworks. And in fact, at the end of that Google Doc, I didn't put a list that says, you know, additional frameworks that for tackling wicked problems, but if you know of any, throw them down at the bottom of that Google Doc. But I'll take a moment and sort of from Musavi's perspective, where in this last paper, this researcher started to apply a more critical view of APT and say, is what I did with the coastal brownfield transformation, which was a participatory type of environmental initiative, did it meet adaptive, participatory, and transdisciplinary methodologies? So, is it iterative, nonlinear decision-making approaches? These are adaptive processes. Does it consider the long-term possibilities to maximize flexibility? Does it constantly re-examine and is open to reframing the problems as new knowledge that is collectively built? And then adaptive responses, are they modifiable and responsive to a range of scenarios as opposed to rigid and fixed? Participatory, they reference the International Association of Public Participation to assess evaluating participatory interventions from a transdisciplinary approach. Are we just informing the public? Are we consulting the public? Are we involving the public? Are we collaborating with the public, or are we empowering the public? And then transdisciplinary is that it works with interdisciplinary tensions by melding knowledge from each of the relevant disciplines, as well as colloquial or community evidence. And that solutions are co-created and place-based and potentially unique. And that it is a robust transdisciplinary approach goes beyond simple integration and acknowledges the messy politics. In fact, we call them wicked problems, but they're also called social messes. Messy politics of achieving consensus among radically different ways of knowing to enable collaborative understanding of an issue. So, I started getting really interested in all of these topics, and I started hanging around all of the international science for team science. So they, because of the pandemic, you can go to these talks and they put them online. You can watch all of the talks. And I was taught about this idea of our metaphor that disciplinary, you know, strawberries hang out with strawberries, bananas hang out with bananas, apples hang out with apples. Multidisciplinary, we might be working on the same problem, but it's parallel. We're not really talking to each other so much. Interdisciplinary is like a fruit salad. So we're kind of all in there, and we might be creating, you know, we're like definitely, we all get in one bite together. But transdisciplinarity is actually creating a smoothie where the defining separateness goes away. Now, whether or not this includes academic and non-academic partners is actually kind of a question in the literature. This one model of transdisciplinary acknowledges that we can have academic participants and you can have low integration where you have multidisciplinarity going. You can include non-academic participants and it can be participatory, but it may not actually be research. Or you can have high integration where you get into fruit salad here, or where it's highly integrative and it includes academic and non-academic participants, we have transdisciplinarity. So here's a little bit of a provocative question. Are these methodologies that are participatory and adaptive and don't have a clear right or wrong answer, are these not real silent science? Strongly agree to strongly disagree. And this is anonymous, so I won't be able to know. We won't be able to see who said what. Okay. Now, if you came to this talk, we might be speaking to the choir a little bit, but, and I have a good reason for saying that. I'm not just coming out with some judgment. I have a story behind that. So, all right. So most of us in the room do consider, that this type of work, transdisciplinary methodologies are disagree with it. They're not science. I've got a double negative here. Okay. So just for a moment, just type in a little bit. What is your reason for that answer that you just provided? These are the moments I take for just breathing a little bit. It may depend on who is defining the science good, because science is about rigorous process of discovery. Nice. Hard data isn't everything. It may depend on who's defining the science. We said that, what is real science? Wow, what is real science? Well, my brother says it's when you go, oh, where's the start, you know? And you go, Okay, that's good. Anybody else want to add? We've got four, that's pretty good. Okay, so thank you for those. Seems self-evident that everything is connected and science is a process for finding truths. I could stay here like for 10 or 15 minutes and hear everybody's response to that, to this question. But I do want to make sure I cover everything. So I think we'll move ahead. But maybe this can be the start of a continued dialogue about it. Well, I went to Web of Science and put in transdisciplinary and in all fields, so not just titles, but all fields that you can search. And this is what we have in 1996. And this is what we have in 2020. So not a surprise to anyone, but I kind of like to see it. And then, you know, you can break it down like this to see kind of the disciplines where that word is being used in published literature. And we've got environmental sciences, studies, public environmental occupational health, engineering, educational research, social sciences, green sustainable technology, and so forth. And then, you know, Web of Science, I love it. So then you can find out about funding. So here is, you can't choose, it got too messy to choose a high number. So these are the top 10 of where the papers that were published noted that they were getting their funding from. Okay, so it's a thing, right? Transdisciplinarity, we're supposed to be doing it. And I don't mean this in any kind of offensive way. But I have to be honest that we have been through something really big. And so if we were really, really knocking it out of the park in terms of transdisciplinarity and solving the sustainable development goals, you know, why are we having this experience? And I just started to noodle on, you know, maybe it's that we have the cart before the horse. The cart is that we have to work transdisciplinarily. But the horse is how. How do we do it? And of course, E.O. Wilson's in 1999 says we have no map for it. And I certainly think we are way ahead of that. I mean, there are people in this room that are doing outstanding work around this topic. But yet we still, all of us have just gone through this pretty intense experience of things like science denialism and just everything. I don't need to put it into words. We all kind of have our own experience of what it's been like. So what is the horse? So here's where I wanna ask you to use the Zoom annotate feature. Now it's at the bottom of your screen, I think. So you see here annotate, and then after you click annotate, you can choose stamp. Okay, so that's what we're gonna do. I'm gonna tell you a story real quick. So as I said, I have this botanist brother. And actually my brother has hung around here at UT a bit at NIMBIOS. He had a whole semester that he spent here at NIMBIOS. He's really kind of a plant geneticist. He's got a faculty position down at the University of Charleston. And he is also really interested in studying like networks, which they do a lot of that work over at NIMBIOS. And he started was studying networks and how networks function with roots, like plant roots, but then, you know, pollination and all sorts of things. Well, this one day I went to go visit him and he was talking about muscles. It was the same kind of network thing about muscles and how muscles, travel. I'm not sure exactly what it was. And it was a Friday night. We may have had a very appropriate amount of whiskey, very appropriate amount. And I said, well, Alan, don't you want to know about the guys that, you know, get the muscles, like that are farming the muscles? Isn't that valuable information to you? And he's like a, you know, botanist, statistician, network kind of guy. And he was like, no. And I was like, you're heartless. Why don't you want to know about this guy? And he's like, because I'm a scientist. And so we went back and forth quite a bit. And I really learned something. And some of you in the room are like, I absolutely understand where your brother's coming from, or at least you know people that are like that. And I have since learned from talking with many of you and others over the past couple of years, that this is actually an important tension that I think we would serve well to give voice to and to respect and honor and to figure out how to work with. So on the one side, and this comes from our good colleague, Associate Dean of Research, Susie Allard, who mentored me about this. One day I was talking to her with all my excitement, and I was like, she's like, well, it's deep science, you know, it's going deep and narrow and very specific, because I was telling what my brother was saying. And she said, and then there's also wide science, which is the larger context. It crosses and ties together between deep sciences. And so so that helped me have better feelings about, you know, what my interaction with my brother. I'm kind of kidding, we had a good time. But here's my question to you, using the annotation tool, where do you most like to be, right? Like, you know, you're supposed to do transdisciplinary work, but if we're just thinking about you, like your personality style, what you enjoy most, where do you most like to be? Do you like to be over here doing deep science, you know, just going deeply into your topic and not dealing with the messiness of the world, just going straight into that, like my brother, like that those genetics, those assays? Or do you really like to be in wide science? So you use the annotate tool. Let me know if you have it.
I don't think a lot of us have that tool available.
Oh, thank you so much. Okay. So if you go to more, do you see it?
No.
Elizabeth, no. I think that is our fault on the settings. That wasn't turned on before this meeting. I just turned it on, but...
Okay, here's what we're going to do. Quickly solve problems. We're going to put this as a 10. So deep science is a 10. And... wide science is a 1. So there's a 10 deep science and a 1 wide science. And you'd have to kind of share your identity, but go ahead and put yourself, are you at a 10? You're totally deep science, or 1 totally wide science, or are you somewhere in between? How would you rate yourself in between? Okay, we've got 1, 2, I know Christy. Hi, Christy. Holly, 7. Oh, this is so great. Okay, good. 3.7, 3.7, 3 to 4. Okay, good. 8 and 9, yes. I love it. I'm at an 8 to 9, but I like 1 and 2 as a beer discussion. Great. I'm at a 9, that's great. Oh, sorry, meant 2 or 3. I was wondering, Christina, good. 8 and sometimes a 2. Exactly. Yeah. Right. You can have like different moments of your personality that come out. Yeah. So I think one of the things maybe that is part of the horse is just naming this part of you know, who we actually are and what we actually like to do. Christy, okay, y'all have to have a date. Okay, so here's where I wanna share a little bit more about what I think might be also part of the horse and part of this wide science thing is liberating structures. So liberating structures, some of you in this room already have gotten a hard copy book from me on liberating structures. It's a book that focuses on introducing tiny shifts in the way we meet, plan, decide, relate to one another. They put the innovative power once reserved for experts only in the hands of everyone. And it's written by these two guys, Henry Lippmanowitz and Keith McCandless. I wanna take a moment before diving straight into it to talk about the brain for a little bit. So this is a screenshot from a video by a psychologist named Ian McGilchrist, who is basically talking about the two sides of the brain. And he's saying that the old way of understanding the two, and if there are any neuroscientists in the room, I have lay knowledge about this. And so I love to be wrong, so please correct me. But in the old days, of course, they thought, well, the left brain is logical and the right brain is artistic. That's very simplistic, and then they found out that that was not true. And so then they threw the whole idea of left brain, right brain differences out the window. And Ian McGilchrist is like, no, you can't do that either because they definitely are different and they serve different purposes. So the left brain is narrow focused attention. So it's about getting, like this bird is getting to the grit or the pebbles and finding the food. It knows that food is there and it's very narrow focused to find the food. The right side of the brain, however, is open and monitoring, broadly vigilant to look for essentially danger and then maybe like friends, right, for survival. So the left side of the brain is the right side of the brain is sustained, broad, open, vigilant, and alert. It is not looking for things that it knows. It is this open, non-knowing, receptive state. The left side of the brain is narrow, sharply focused attention to detail. And when I watch this video, and even when I look at this image, I have memories of being a doctoral student and like writing and being like, oh, I can't say that because I have no reference for it. You know? So that is that's narrowly focused, sharp and focused attention to detail. And it's necessary. It's a part of building knowledge, right? What I would want to invite you is, first of all, if you want to know, Ian McGilchrist, the mind and his emissary, you'll have to figure out which one is which by reading the brain, or you can watch this video at the bottom, which one is which. But the reason I wanted to pause here to talk about the brain is that liberating structures is asking us to grow in this area without giving up this area. But it's definitely this direction. It's definitely this direction. So so just putting a little frame about what we're heading into with the rest of the content for today. So this was a cool thing. Earlier this week on the 26th, one of the co-authors of Liberating Structures did a Zoom, open, free Zoom session on climate change using one of the Liberating Structures tools called critical uncertainties. The two of them are really accessible. This is Henry. And about 3 days after, no, that's not true. 3 days after me really looking into liberating structures, I was in a one-on-one Zoom meeting with Henry. So they're very, very accessible guys. And they have essentially curated a repertoire of 33 different activities for organizing interactions that include and unleash everyone in shaping next steps. They have a book, and the book is really the only place where they get money. They have a website, which is very detailed and full. They have a free app where you can string together different liberating structures that you might, which each of them have a different purpose that you might want to use to try to tackle a problem. They have these cards. I don't have the cards. And then they have this free, robust Slack community. But this is the coolest thing, is that it's all Creative Commons. Use them, share them, just can't sell them. So because of the open access, the way that it's they're leaning into making their content more open access, it's kind of spreading like a spider plant. Yesterday, on Tuesday, when I was in the meeting, there were, I think, about 20 people from across the globe that were just in this free Zoom meeting talking about sustainability, utilizing liberating structures. I will share with those of you that have attended, I'll put to have a Google Doc, and there is a list of references that are ways in which liberating structures are starting to be used in higher education, and certainly in addressing wicked problems. And I want to shout out that some of the first published papers are from nursing. So the premise of liberating structures is that we have these conventional microstructures that we already use. So one of them is a presentation, another is a managed discussion, another is a status update, and then we move to, and so they're on this continuum of control. So these are kind of over-controlled. And then we have under-controlled, so that's brainstorming and open discussion. Another way to look at it is we have one person that's kind of shaping next steps versus everybody shaping next steps. Distributed control, so control is wide in the hands of a wide group of folks versus centralized control. So here we have, you know, more centralized control. Here we have less centralized control, but not an, less direction. And so liberating structures is kind of this sweet spot where things are distributed to everyone, but there's also control that people have. Another way to, or liberating structures are useful when challenges stretch across and are embedded in many levels. So from small to large parts and short-term to long-term issues. They're helpful to use when you're trying to make progress where everyone needs to change their behavior at least a little. They're helpful when the place to start or focus of attention seems to keep shifting because there's no simple cause or effect to the problem. And they're useful when solutions gain clarity only as the work unfolds. There's that statement that you're kind of building the airplane as you're flying. But what that comes down to is that importing best practices in a unilateral top-down way don't end up working. So the way in which control is understood is that we're striving for a balance. So you gain from control to be able to calm things down and create predictability and equilibrium. You gotta calm things down sometimes, organize it. But you gain from distributing control by stirring things up and promoting creative adaptability. So, single, monolithic, or overly controlled are one way flow down from the top, where only a few folks are engaged in shaping the direction. Versus on the other end, we have no plan, which is under controlled, where there's infinite possibilities too disconnected and uncoordinated to shape a direction. So sometimes if we have a town hall or we have a brainstorming session, it ends up being like this. But if we have a PowerPoint presentation or a status report, it ends up being like this. Liberated is when there's distributed control, that you can flow from any point of direction and is shaped by participants out of a local global interaction. So one of the probably most powerful things about liberating structures is that they're expertless. So they're designed to be used by you, not by people that are trained facilitators. In fact, in the talk on Tuesday that I went to, Keith McCandless reported that sometimes what he runs into most in a most challenging way in some environments that he engages is people that are trained facilitators who don't want to give up the control and allow anybody to use these tools, like critical uncertainties or 1-2-4 all, or the 15% solutions, which are all unique liberating structures. It's results focused. There is rapid cycling in the liberating structure. So think about sometimes you get into a meeting and it just kind of stays on one topic too long and solutions aren't come to, the people don't come to a solution or a plan of action. So this is results focused, rapid cycling. It's inclusive, it's multi-scale, it's self-spreading, modular. And in the end, it's fun. The way to organize it is that you make an invitation with a clear purpose, you distribute participation, you configure breakout groups, you arrange virtual space, and you sequence and allocate time, which is probably the most important part of making a liberating structures application to a wicked problem most effective. There are some principles in liberating structures. You never start without a clear purpose. In fact, if your liberating structure workshop or meeting failed, it's because the purpose of that meeting was not clear. You include and unleash everyone, everybody's voice. You practice deep respect for people and local solutions. You build trust as you go. You learn by failing forward. So it's not about avoiding failure at all. It's about doing it quickly, doing it well, and learning very quickly and well. And if you think back to the concept of wicked problems and what makes a wicked problem, this aspect of liberating structures can serve managing wicked problems well. Practice self-discovery within a group, amplify freedom and responsibility, emphasize possibilities before believe before you see. And that is that right brain skill set that is sometimes not as rewarded in maybe the scientific endeavors that may be affiliated with more deep science. Now, I say that humbly. So I love disagreement, and we'll have a moment for dialogue. So I hope that if that's wrong, I want to hear what you have to share about that. It invites creative destruction to enable innovation and engage in seriously playful curiosity. I think about some of the studies looking at enriched environments and fear with sows. I saw this one study. This is not my area at all, so I'm really failing forward here if I say something wrong, but environments where there were things to play with, the little baby sows were not afraid of the caregiver. They were like very inquisitive and really willing to go out and check things out. And environments where there was nothing to play with, they were way more afraid. So liberating structures allows us to both have serious science, hardcore serious science, and play, that these are not mutually exclusive and I think can feed each other very, very well. So here are some resources liberating structures. There's the liberating structures book, there's a user group here, there's a Slack group, Liberating Structures website, and we will link up the Google document and the Google folder so that, and I'll keep populating it so that you can access resources if you're interested. This is a QR code to the Google Play Store app of Liberating Structures, which is free. It's kind of more fun to read about each liberating structure on the app as opposed to on the website. These are just some climate crisis resources that they shared on last Tuesday. So that's what I wanted to share with you all about Liberating Structures. I think I'll take one moment and just show you the website. So you can find field stories of how Liberating Structures have been used. For instance, we have some here in academic leadership. And then here's the menu. So you have the overall menu here, and then you can click on any of these. This is one of my favorite ones, is Wicked Questions. And read about how to organize it. So this is the structuring invitation. How is space arranged? How much time does it take? How is participation distributed? How do you configure your groups? And here are the sequence and time allocations, why you would use this tool, and then the tips and traps. So, and this is, and then riffs and variations and examples of how it could be used, and then collateral material. So it's extremely rich resource. And this is so that you, tomorrow, can use a liberating structure in some meeting that you want to run. This is not about being an expert. It's really anyone is invited to jump in and see what liberating structure might do to the project that you're passionate about. I'm interested in liberating structures. If you're interested in liberating structures, I want to visit with you, and I would love to have a cup of tea or do some research together, or so I hope you'll reach out. That's my cell phone. Text me, call me. That's my email address. I also wanted to share a little bit of information from our good colleague, Dr. Mehmet Adenez, who is with the College of Education, Health, and Human Sciences. He has started something called CoLabs. And initially, Mehmet and I were going to co-present today, but he was not able to be here. And so I hope that he will provide for you a noontime lecture on what he's got going on. In addition to his mission and vision for what CoLabs is all about, I happen to know that he also is teaching a whole class right now on science collaboration. This is the first semester that it's being delivered. And then he's also conducting some research on looking at scientists and what contributes to their leadership around collaboration. So great colleague to reach out to. And then we have plenty of time. I kind of miraculously we have 10 minutes for dialogue. Or for you to go and walk around and get a cup of coffee before you go to your next thing. But I do want to point out that we have a save the date, please. On March 10th from 10 to 3, we're going to have an armchair virtual dialogue and an experience on the science of team science with Steve Porges, who is the founder of something called polyvagal theory. Polyvagal theory is well known in traumatology, but he does a lot of work around what it takes for a nervous system to be safe. And psychological safety turns out to be an extremely important factor in successful interdisciplinary teams. And so we're going to have Steve Porges talk with Steve Fiore, who is currently the president of the International Network of the Science of Team Science, Insights. And I also want to do a shout out that because of ORIDE and their Expanding Horizons program that I get to be a part of this year, I'm able to have Steve Fiore as my mentor in these topics this year. So That's a wonderful program that ORIDE has got going on and has made this possible, because Steve wouldn't have given me much attention without that. So it's going to be exciting. I'm really excited to hear what these two guys have to say to each other. And I actually think, because it's virtual, I think that we'll be able to invite all of y'all's networks and have people non physically at UT be able to participate. So that's what I wanted to share with you all today. And I'd love to hear if you have any comments or thoughts or ideas. And I actually want to pull up this. Google Doc. Alyssa, would you mind to pull up and share the Google Doc real quick?
Okay, can you see that?
Yes. Well, great. So we've got a little bit going on there. That's great. Wonderful. Deans and department heads. We definitely have deans here. Yeah. We have a few associate deans for research and academic affairs. So that's exciting. So thank you for sharing that, Alyssa. And please, if you didn't get the word, we're just trying to collect information about people that are engaged in consilience. Any ideas or thoughts that people want to share before we sign off?
Javiette Samuel is someone you might want to include.
Oh, thank you, yeah.
As of academic outreach and engagement.
That's great, yeah, thank you. Okay, everyone.
I could also make the argument, Elizabeth, that you might want to talk to Dr. Ernest Brothers. And the connection there is that the liberating structures and some of the other tools you've talked about are far more inclusive, and they make more space for underrepresented people. And, you know, we know at the university that there's been issues in the past about women and people of racial minorities. So, and he's just such a good stimulator of discussion. So again, as you look to people to include, you might want to consider him.
Yes, thank you for that. This is co-creation of knowledge. And so Carol, those two names are so important. You know who I don't have on that list is Ferlin. I didn't put Ferlin's name, but certainly he needs to be there, yeah. Mm-hmm. Anybody else? Comments or? I love disagreements the most, or challenges to the ideas of liberating structures or what was covered today. Well, I hope everyone has a really good day, and thank you for your presence and attention, and take good care. Bye.
Thank you, Elizabeth.
Thank you.